Welcome to the Alain Guillot Podcast, where we speak about personal finance and entrepreneurship. This is episode number 54. Today, we have with us Brian Portnoy, the author of two books, The Investor's Paradox and The Geometry of Wealth. Today, we tackle the subject of the role of money in our happiness. Brian, thank you so much for coming to the show. Can we start by you telling us who are you and what do you do?
Yeah, sure. So, Brian Portnoy, I'm the Director of Investment Education for Virtus Investment Partners. We are a U.S.-based asset manager. We work with financial advisors all over the place, trying to provide solutions in equity and fixed income and real estate market and some other markets so that they can best help the end client. As the director of education, I do a couple things. One, I write a fair bit, produce a lot of content about mostly on this field of behavioral finance, which is a fancy way of just talking about how humans make decisions about money. And then secondly, I travel around actually all over the world, and I give talks and seminars on that same broad topic, sometimes to financial advisors, sometimes to individual investors.
Okay, but looking in your profile, I see that you have a PhD on, I believe, political science. How is it that from political science, you ended up working in this field?
Yeah, so it's been a long and fun and interesting journey. So I started off my career in more of an academic field. And so when I was in the political science department at the University of Chicago, for those who know how the UFC is really set up, it was very interdisciplinary. So I studied politics and sociology, economics and business. And broadly speaking, my area of expertise was in sort of the social and political and economic institutions that constitute global capitalism. So how does capitalism work from a variety of perspectives was what I wrote about. So that was what I focused on. I decided to forego an academic career. I had an opportunity to work in Chicago with a firm called Morningstar that I'm sure you and a lot of your listeners are familiar with, to start doing some investment research for them. And that sort of started me off on what's now almost a 20-year career in investments, portfolio management, and investment education.
Can we go back a little bit and can you tell us about the mental process of giving up this career for which you spend so much time and effort, just throwing it all away and getting into something unknown to you, which is investments?
Well, I wouldn't say it was unknown, but I understand your question. I decided that what I was doing at that point in my life was not something that I wanted to pursue, even though I had, you know, put in a lot of time, you know, the sort of notion of sunk costs that economists might talk about. I was pretty comfortable in saying, you know what, I'm not particularly happy with what I'm doing right now. And there are other things that interest me. There are other opportunities that I can pursue. So some people at the time, you know, thought maybe I was a little bit crazy because I did have some success in that world as a writer and as a professor. But I wanted to do something else. And the thing is, and this is a really important point that I like to make to a lot of people, especially my children, which is that, you know, there's a core set of skills that we develop as people that are applicable across any number of domains. I mean, obviously, there's the need for technical knowledge if you're going to be a physician or if you're going to build rocket ships or, you know, anything that requires, you know, years and years of technical training. But from a critical thinking point of view, which everybody needs if they want to be a good employee, a good citizen, a good parent, a good spouse, is to have the ability to read and write across different disciplines and think about different problems from a variety of different angles. And so without question, both at university as well as graduate school, I developed that skill. So those tools in critical thinking that have carried me through a very nonlinear, but, you know, I think interesting career.
Okay, I have a question, and this has been a debate with me and my friends for a long time. And I'm sure, I don't know if you're going to resolve this debate, but when it comes to education, if I study, let's say, accounting or computer science, I feel like I'm going to have a job right away, and not only a job, but a well-paid job. On the other hand, if I study, let's say, English literature or history or anthropology, I don't know about that. And those are the skills or the careers that we consider as critical thinking, or that I perceive as critical thinking. And yet, I will find a lot of these people working in Starbucks. So I know that. And then at the higher level, the CEOs and the high earners and the people who get along well, they have develop these critical thinking skills to get them to the top. But it seems like there is a big chunk of people in the middle of the English major, history majors, anthropology majors, who are stuck in that until they somehow break through and make it to, I don't know, in a more successful way into the career. What's your input about that?
It's a good question. It's a timely question. I've got three teenage kids, so I not only think about this. There's real consequences to having the correct answer. I'm broadly a fan of a liberal arts education and developing those critical skills. Let's keep in mind that our children, let alone our grandchildren, have a very high probability of working in industries that don't even exist yet. Okay, so the underlying theme of capitalism going back 300 to 400 years is this notion of creative destruction, the idea that industries over time change and they come and go. So in the US economy, for example, going back a century, pretty large percentage of the industries that even existed at that time a century ago don't even exist today. So when we think about, well, you get out of school because you know how to be an engineer and you just go do that. You know, that can be a very good thing, not only in the short term, but the long term. But I would say that it's more likely to be smart in the short term, because if you're trained for something in the here and now that exists in the here and now, that's great. But the world's going to change. The firm that you work for, there's a good chance it won't even exist in 10 or 20 years. The idea, you know, going back three, four, five decades that, you know, you would get a job out of college with a particular company. And, you know, that was going to be where you were going to work over the course of your entire career. That really doesn't exist anymore. People not only change jobs multiple times, they change careers multiple times. So if you don't have any experience or perspective, if you haven't read enough about how the process of adaptation works, how to engage in critical thinking, how to first and foremost know yourself, then I don't think you're going to be in as good of a position as you could be.
And wouldn't you say that maybe critical thinking is something that you develop along the way, you know, working and struggling and living life? Then you learn how to analyze. And before we get that, well, we need the skills that are going to allow us to pay the rent today, that will allow us to pay the student loans. There is such an epidemic of student loan debts in the United States, and people who cannot find a job, and it's just a struggle.
Yes. I mean, there's a couple levels to the problem. One is paying your bills in the here and now, and another level is evolving into the person that you want to be down the road, and then when you get to that person, realizing that, well, you want to be somebody even different in the years to come. You pointed it out, and it's correct. You know, critical thinking isn't something, it's not a course that you take. It's an attitude toward life where you're going to engage across many different disciplines. You're gonna put yourself in a position to be wrong and to learn lessons and to grow. You know, I'm in my late 40s, and I read as much now as I ever have, including during my PhD days. And I learn something new almost every day about the world, about myself, about the way to solve problems. So yeah, it's a commitment and it's a lifestyle. I think it's a fascinating and a fun one. I think it's where you meet not only meet the most interesting people, it's also where you find the most lucrative opportunities from a business point of view. Because those who engage in this, they're the ones that are building the companies of tomorrow. It's not the person who had a great job at age 23 because they took the right coursework in college and then tried to stay in that job. That person's, you know, there's some chance or good chance that person will be in that job, but then gets passed over because they don't have the ability to change their skill set as the needs of industry change.
Okay, great. Okay, so let's move on to your career. Let's go back to, so you started working at Morningstar, and how did that develop into where you are today and also to the process of writing two books?
Well, so I started out at Morningstar in 2000 as a fund analyst. I was there for about 4 years, and the company was considerably smaller than it is today, but a lot of the senior people then are senior people today, whether it be Joe Mansueto or Don Phillips or Kunal Kapoor, Christine Benz, Jeffrey Patak, and so forth. So I learned how to do investment analytics. I mean, the hard part wasn't the substance. You know, I after my PhD, I sat and passed the exams for the to be a chartered financial analyst. And, you know, so I learned the vocabulary and all that stuff. That just takes time. It's not particularly difficult. But I already had the passion to learn and to be able to write and communicate and conduct an interview and a lot of the other things that go into that. So, yeah, I did that for a few years, and then I got hired away to do a slightly similar job at another Chicago-based firm in the fund of hedge funds industry, which, you know, I did for a good 10 years or so, which was basically evaluating and selecting hedge funds to go into portfolios for that firm's institutional client base. So, you know, the first book that I wrote, The Investor's Paradox, spoke to those 14 years at Morningstar and the other firm, Mesirow, where I estimate I interviewed something like 4,000 different portfolio managers across I don't think there's a strategy on the planet, from long-only equity and fixed income to capital structure arbitrage and global macro and long-short equity. You name it, I was on a team that covered the globe. And I learned a lot, partly just by being around, but also by making some really terrible decisions and, you know, having the urge at a certain, you know, juncture in my career, this was about 7-8 years ago, to sort of put down on paper what I thought I had perceived. And, you know, for anybody who's written a book, you kind of know that you started off with an idea, but then the book, you know, kind of takes on a life of itself. So my first book, you know, I started writing in one direction and it became a much broader exploration of decision making. And then that led to the second book.
Okay. I just have to confess something. I have a love-hate relationship with Morningstar. The love part is I love the articles, the information provided, the comparison, and the tools that it just gives is amazing. The hate part is that when I was a beginner investor, I used to rely on the 5 stars of Morningstar. So I used to say, oh, this fund has 5 stars, so it must be a great investment. I'm going to put all my money in there. And then I was so heartbroken when my 5-star mutual fund that I choose to Morningstar didn't perform as the past 5, 10, and 20 years that they mentioned. So it took me a while to learn that past results does not guarantee future performance.
Yeah, well, that's frankly on you and not Morningstar. They've written about 10,000 articles on that exact point. You know, you have to evaluate. You have to evaluate investments from a number of different perspectives, and one of them is their performance relative to your expectations, relative to particular benchmarks, relevant benchmarks. And, you know, so the star rating, which I don't think Morningstar, you know, says is a great decision-making tool, it is an opportunity to evaluate how a fund has done on a risk-adjusted basis relative to other funds trying to do something similar. But, you know, there's a larger problem in the investment business that we get sucked into trying to find the hot investments and the hot trends. And, you know, for example, you look at the FANG stocks in Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, Google over the last 5 years, and they've so far exceeded the returns of, you know, the U.S. stock market, the S&P 500. I mean, you can chase those returns, but, you know, that's a pretty good way in the medium to long term to end up with some pretty terrible results. So, yeah, not buying on the basis of past performance is, you know, that's something that everyone should keep in mind. I will say from a behavioral perspective, that's a lot easier to say than it is to act upon, because we do say, oh, you know, hey, this has done really well. And then we just make the subconscious assumption that, well, if it's done well, it'll continue to do well. And that's sometimes not the case.
Well, I do accept all responsibility. I know now, after a few more years, that it's on me and not a Morningstar. But anyways, that's, as you said, that's the trap that we all fall into. And it's nice to also bring some awareness about this issue, that 5-star doesn't guarantee that you're going to outperform the markets for the next 5, 10, 15 years.
Yeah, and let me add one more thing, that if any of your listeners are thinking about investing in the context of, as you put it, trying to beat the market, then they're doing it wrong. I mean, I just want to be very blunt and straight about that. If the focus of your investments is to beat an arbitrary benchmark, then you are not investing. You are gambling. You are speculating. You may as well just go to the casino.
Amen for saying that. I mean, that's the way of thinking that I have developed now after a few years. But I see some of my friends getting interested in the investment sector. And exactly, it seems like we all have to go through the same traps and the same falling down on our face to learn the lessons eventually.
Yep.
Okay, so let's go into your second book. From just by looking at the cover, I see geometrical figures, and I also see the title of Wealth in there. So can you tell us what is the book about, and what does the three geometrical figures represent?
Yeah, sure, thanks. So the book's called The Geometry of Wealth, How to Shape a Life of Money and Meaning, and it's a prequel to The Investor's Paradox, meaning that this book, if you want to read them in the right order, you read The Geometry of Wealth first, and then The Investor's Paradox second, even though that's not the order in which they were read. You know, so the question that the first book answered some years ago was, well, how do I make good investment decisions? This next book starts further back in the chain of events, and it addresses, well, before I figure out what my portfolio is going to look like, why don't I put some thought into what I want my life to look like? And it broadly addresses the question that I hear in the wealth management business every day from financial advisors and from clients, which is, am I going to be okay? I think at the end of the day, we might find stock picking interesting. We might say, you know, try to pick one good mid-cap value fund versus another. But that's not actually really in any way closely related to the bigger picture question of, you know, what's going to make me happy? What's going to drive a meaningful life? So I wanted to address that in the broad sense, but I wanted to anchor it in a more narrow sense of filtering everything through money, because money is an unavoidable topic in life. There's really not a day goes by that we don't spend something or try to save or come up with a plan or go to work and earn money. You know, it's just around us. So where does money fit into a happy life? Where does money fit into a meaningful life? And my answer is that to be truly wealthy is to have the ability to underwrite a meaningful life, as distinct from being rich, which to me I define as just having more. And I show, I think, somewhat conclusively from a psychological perspective that having more does not produce greater long-term happiness. It just puts us on a treadmill where we sprint and sprint but don't get any further. So if wealth is the ability to underwrite a meaningful life, or what I'll refer to sometimes in the book as funded contentment, then the three shapes, the circle, the triangle, and the square, is my answer. So how do we lead a wealthy life? Well, it starts with defining our purpose, and then it moves to setting broad priorities in our money life, not just investing, but earning, spending, and saving. And then it gets to more tactical decisions. about your investment portfolio. And as you pointed out at the very beginning, those tactical investment decisions are important, but unless they're made within this broader context, they're not going to be nearly as effective as they could be. And I'm happy to dive into the any of the shapes that you want.
Okay, yeah, we will dive a little bit into the circle, but before we get that, we get there. So we humans, we have this, our human nature is to always strive for more. And not only that, but advertisers know that those are our human weaknesses, and they pump us with all this advertisement to buy the newest car and the bigger house. So it feels like we are always finding on how to have more money to buy more things. And it feels like content is so far away. And only after you have lived a life full of experiences, you discover that, you know, your happiness is not dependent on whether you have the latest brand of car or the biggest house, but on the kind of quality of life that you are living. So, and going back to your book that you think you wrote them in reverse order, I don't agree with you. I think you wrote them in the order that we think that our human instincts drive us. And perhaps now that you are older, you reflect back and say, okay, so these are the important things that we should consider in our life before we get into the tactics of how to earn more money. But this is you reflecting back after the experience of your life. And this is not just for you, but for all of us. We don't find content because we are always wanting more and more and more. And only in retrospect, we discover that, no, to be happy, we don't need more. We just need to have a good friends around us. And, you know, the material things become less important.
Mm-hmm. And that's the flow of the book. So, and I appreciate your comment about the order in which I wrote them. You know, I'm older now. My kids are older. I think about things differently. So, yeah, hopefully I'm a little bit wiser than I was a decade ago when I started the first book. But, you know, we do have to start with the bigger picture question about what do we think is going to drive purpose and meaning in our life. You know, you made a compelling case that it's hard to shake this quest for more, and I can't disagree. I think you're spot on. The underlying tension in the book, I don't know if tension's even the right word, but it's sort of there throughout the book, and then in the final chapter, I tackle it head on at some length. It is really the tension in our lives between wanting more and having enough. So that push for more versus the push for enough, I really think from a genetic and an evolutionary point of view, we want both. Because the more that we want, now you can put it in the material terms, you know, like the new car, the bigger house, those are proxies, healthy or not, and arguably unhealthy, for the idea that we're moving forward. There is a healthy version of wanting more, which is that we want to grow. And why is that? Well, because our brains were wired a very long time ago to survive in a dangerous world. And so if we don't feel like we are growing and moving forward and accomplishing new things, acquiring new things, we feel like we're falling behind. Okay, so if you're at the front of a line, not moving forward, you're not going to feel as good as someone toward the back of the line who is moving forward. That sense of moving forward in one way or another is really important to us. But the flip side is that having enough is also something that's quite rewarding. It's actually where we find that quiet space where we can engage in mindfulness and be thoughtful about what it is that we are experiencing in the here and now and even more broadly. So it's not surprising that in our incredibly noisy world, you know, especially in big cities like, you know, Chicago where I live and New York and San Francisco and Toronto and Montreal and Vancouver and Houston and you name it, what do you see all over the place now? You see yoga. You see mindfulness centers. You see people trying to get back in their heads because all of the data and all of the noise and all of the choices are sucking us out of our heads. And it's a very uncomfortable thing that's going on. So that more versus enough dynamic is natural. I don't think it could be reconciled or stopped. I don't think there's a button that you can push where you just find that perfect balance. But what I try to do in the book a little bit throughout the whole story, but then explicitly for a while in the final chapter, in chapter 10, is say, well, at least here's a way to think about it. Here are some mental models to keep us in balance between wanting more and cherishing enough. And that, so far, that's the best I could come up with.
So how do we identify purpose? And more importantly, how do we help a young person to identify purpose? Because if a young person identifies purpose, now they have like a compass to guide them through the rest of their life. And my hope is that a lot of young people read this book, your book, and that help them identify where to go in life. So as a young person, how will someone identify his purpose?
There's a chapter in the book called What Matters that I would encourage people to dig into. And what I do there is, based on a ton of reading over many years and also just living life. But looking at philosophy and religion and psychology and economics and anthropology and so forth, what seemed to be the deeper sources of contentment throughout the human experience going back many, many millennia? And I point to four, just as a mnemonic. I call them the four C's: connection, control, contentment, and context. And I'll say a word about each of those in a moment. But the general idea is that there are a handful of things, ideas, experiences that we can have that go beyond kind of the day-to-day up and down mood swings, happy day, happy, sad, good day, bad day, affect, just sort of that, in the moment experience. Going beyond that to what I call reflective happiness, that sense of meaning or joy or contentment, these four elements sort of speak to that. And when I talk about underwriting meaning, so, if true wealth is the ability to underwrite a meaningful life, then these four things are kind of the source of meaningful life. But in one way or another, each of them costs money. And that can be frustrating for people to hear. They might want to just imagine themselves, walking in the woods peacefully for the rest of their lives. But, for all of us in the real world, it doesn't really work that way at all. So real quick, connection just refers to the fact that we are social animals, and our attachment to others is just about the deepest source of meaning that we have. We are tribal in nature, and we achieve not only safety, but deep fulfillment through our social relationships. Control is the ability to drive your own destiny, to have a sense of a liberty or freedom to approach any variety of opportunities. That's meaningful to us. When we don't have that freedom, we feel miserable, frankly. Contentment, which is the third C, kind of refers to mastery in your job or your vocation. So, when you go to a party and somebody asks, the first question somebody asks you is, what do you do? At least in the States, they do. It's pretty annoying. But, what they're really asking is, who are you? What's your identity? And we tend to associate our identity with the work that we do. And some of us find great meaning in our work, and other of us find our jobs miserable. Those who have more meaningful work tend to have more fulfilled lives. And then the fourth C, I refer to context. It's a broad catch-all category, which just taps into the general idea that people who are living for something outside of their own narrow self-interest tend to be more content. Doesn't mean that they're happier on a day-to-day basis, but in terms of that ability to step back and say, am I leading a good life? When people are attached to something bigger, historically over the millennia, that's been religion and spirituality, but it's any other cause or idea. It could be your nation. It could be patriotism. It could be a motivating idea like environmentalism. It could be anything, really. But those who tend to be overly self-regarding tend to be less happy. And those who have tied their own identity and sense of self-worth to something outside themselves and have that context tend to be happier. So those are the four C's. Those are the things I think we're trying to underwrite.
How can we increase connection? I mean, there is social clubs, and I guess there is the religion affiliations. What would you suggest to amplify connection with other human beings?
Well, that's a big question. You know, well, let's start at the other end. Let me give you an answer that starts at the other end of the situation, which is social media. So we think about the fact that, you know, from a digital point of view, we are more connected to each other than at any point before in human history. Sometimes hard to forget that, you know, Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat and Instagram and WhatsApp and you name it, they weren't around, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago. So this is all relatively new for us. And there is something in principle that's quite exciting about this ability to be connected in this way. But what we've seen is that the rise, social connection in that form has also been associated with a great deal of unhappiness, with misery, with loneliness, with depression, in no small part because, you know, these platforms have become for many an opportunity to show others, you know, what they have or what they're doing. And so the experiences, you know, we used to go on a vacation and you couldn't share anything on the vacation other than photos after the fact. But now, you know, whatever you do, going to a meal or, you know, going on a vacation, you can post pictures all day long. And the enjoyment tends to come through others liking your experiences in the moment as distinct from enjoying the moments themselves. So first of all, I think on balance, the real meaningful connections are found, you know, in real life, as my kids would say, IRL, in real life.
Wow, I didn't know that.
And whether it be through your church or through your neighbors, I didn't mention the most obvious one, your family, you know, your parents, your children, your partner. There are so many different overlapping forms of social engagement. I think it would be impossible to say which are the most important, but it's really important to be attached to others in one way or another, at least in the U.S. The science that I've seen has shown that loneliness is approaching epidemic proportions in terms of the survey data. The number of people who now live on their own versus previous generations is at an all-time high. So, you know, we're all together on Facebook or Twitter, but we're quite alone in many of the things that we do. And of course, we all cherish our private time, but it's really, really important that in real life, we have those physical social connections that are meaningful to us.
And I guess it's for that reason that when you compare happiness from one country to another, some of the happiest countries are not necessarily the countries that have the biggest amount of wealth. It's those countries that maybe because of their financial restraints, they are obliged to live in small communities where the grandfather and the mother and the son, you know, you got three generations in one house. So the issue of loneliness is never there. It's mostly a lack of privacy. So people feel connected to these three generations for family members, and the grandmother doesn't have to worry about being in the old people's home. She knows that she's going to be taken care of by their son, daughters, and grandsons, and also the mother knows that the grandmother is going to take care of the baby whenever she goes to work. So yeah, that's that connection, family connection that we find in other countries compared to the United States of North America. Maybe it's because of that, because of the lack of financial means. But, you know, it's at the same time, we all like our privacy as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's a little more complicated than that. There's generally a relationship between national wealth and reported happiness, in no small part because if you look at societies that are poor, where people don't have enough food, where there's a lot of conflict, those tend to be pretty unhappy places. When you get into, you know, other places that have plenty of capital and generally, I don't mean from a distribution of income or wealth point of view, but are generally wealthy, you know, those tend to be the happier economies. But among those, if you look at the most recent World Happiness Report, which is a big, important study that comes out, you know, the United States ranks like 20th or 25th. Canada is considerably higher. The highest is I think Canada's in the, I know Canada's in the top 10. I think it's six or seven. Finland, Norway, Denmark are, you know, right at the top of the list. And you know, there's a whole variety of other things that go into it, you know, including access to healthcare and longevity and things like that. So there's generally a relationship, very generally, between national wealth and national happiness. But then there's a lot of nuance that goes into the actual rankings.
Okay, so one last question about happiness. So you know that there are people who are predisposed to be happy and they find the positive side of almost every situation. And at the same time, there are other people who have beautiful life, but they find always some reason to be unhappy. You know, whether it's there's one cloud in the sky or whether it's 1 degree hotter or colder than they expected. So we have this predisposition of being happy or unhappy. How much of that is genetical and how much of that is under our own control?
Yeah, the answer is about 50%. About 50% of our overall happiness in life is sort of genetic disposition. So some of us are naturally cheerful and others are naturally gloomy, and that's kind of who you are. So, you know, blame your parents or thank your parents. It comes from them and your grandparents and great grandparents and so forth. Then, you know, most of the other half of the equation is up to you. It's through deliberate action and deliberate thought that you can construct a life that is more meaningful or less meaningful. The other piece to the pie, which is a very small wedge, is just situational variables. You know, do you live in a beautiful sunny place? Were you born tall and good looking or short and not good looking? Are you athletic or are you clumsy? All those things. Are you famous? Do you have a lot of money in the bank? All of those things that on a day-to-day level we tend to associate with things being good or bad in our lives actually have a very, very limited impact on our overall sense of happiness.
Okay, and just one last, coming back now to finance and wealth, somewhere along the line, you mentioned that volatility is risk. And I've been trying to train my mind for the past few years that volatility is not equal to risk. So now you are confusing me. Can you go a little bit deeper on this volatility is risk or is no risk?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm happy to confuse you. There is a perspective that's held by some really famous and deservedly famous people like Warren Buffett that volatility is not risk. And by volatility, we mean, you know, the market jumping around all over the place. And, you know, economists or experts in finance, you know, because it's because volatility is quantitatively measurable, they've tend to associate that with risk. And really smart people like Buffett and Howard Marks and others have come along and say that's silly. The only real risk is permanent impairment of capital, of, you know, sort of losing a lot of money and not getting it back. And I guess I have a third perspective, which is that ultimately our success in navigating money life, including investing, is driven by our emotions and our ability to control them. It's really all about behavior. It's not at all about understanding the market or knowing what growth rates are going to be or what the next hot stock is going to be. It sounds like it is, but it's not at all. And so what happens during more volatile times is that people tend to get spooked and they sell out of, you know, particular investments or their entire portfolio. If what we're trying to really do is achieve certain goals, we want to retire comfortably, we want to buy a nice home, we want to support our children or our parents, you know, those are real goals that require a certain amount of either capital or a particular income stream. If in fact volatility sort of emotionally compels us to sell our investments, it's highly unlikely we're going to get back into those investments anytime soon, even though most of those investments are probably going to bounce back maybe even sooner rather than later. And so volatility means that you're going to sell your stuff and you're going to be less and less likely to meet your financial objectives. So that's why volatility is risk.
Okay, and could we say maybe that volatility is risk let's say, for the big majority of people, but there is this little segment of the experts like Warren Buffett who says, oh, volatility is no risk. And there's the other segment of people who are completely oblivious to what's going on in the market. They don't know if their portfolio is up and down. They don't know what they have. They just know that they have somewhere in their digital data a retirement account, and they don't even know what the market is. So for those people, we could say maybe that volatility is no risk because they are not even aware that there is something going on. And then for the experts like Warren Buffett, then it's no risk. But then it would be risk for the big majority of people who check our statements once a month, let's say, to see if they're doing good or not.
Yeah, I mean, I would say once a month is too frequent. I think twice a year, once a year is fine. But I don't ever look at the market. There's really no information in looking at the market every day. I mean, if you're not looking at volatility, then volatility can't be risk. The thing is that many people, especially men, are looking at their portfolio and their investments in the market on a daily basis. And therefore, they're absorbing an enormous amount of noise, not signal, but noise. And that noise is going to lead them to want to make decisions that probably are not in their best interest.
And you say especially men. Why especially men?
Well, women are better investors than men just because of a different genetic makeup. They don't tend to be as overconfident. They tend to be more patient. They don't have as much testosterone, so they're not as aggressive and competitive. And as a result, they're better able to weather market storms. They're better able to think through to the longer term. There's a lot of studies on this, so the science has spoken. Men are generally more aggressive, and men are more likely to treat money as a yardstick for self-worth than women are.
Wow. Okay, Brian, this has been a fantastic conversation. I'm going to ask you some questions that I usually ask at the end of the show. Before I get there, is there anything that maybe I neglected to ask you that I should have?
No, this is great. This is great. We're boiling the ocean here. This is good.
Great. Okay, so my first question is, can you recommend a book that just please you? And it doesn't have to be about finance. It could be whatever you are excited to be reading right now.
Yeah, well, I'm not reading it right now, but I've read it a couple times. And hopefully it's not a recommendation that others have given, but probably have. It's Sapiens by Yuval Harari. I mean, I think it's one of the more important books written in the last decade. And why is that? It's because he has a really almost unparalleled ability as an historian to talk about what it means to be human and how we grew to be human over thousands of years. So as we think about our current age of digital media and exabytes of data and all the other and robotics and artificial intelligence, the historical perspective that he gives on our trek from being hunter-gatherers to being in an agricultural-oriented society to a more industrial society to where we are now and more of a service and knowledge-based society. It's just a tour de force. I think anybody who wants to think about the meaning of their life within a historical context, this is the number one book to read.
I agree with you. And according to Sapien, our human species have been in decline since the discovery of agriculture.
That is his point of view. That's probably his most controversial one, that we sort of peaked in terms of the happiness of our species about 6,000 years ago. This probably isn't the place to debate that. But that is definitely a view of his. And there's something to it.
Okay, great. And how about one resource? It could be a podcast, a YouTube channel, a blog, something that we should check out as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think for people interested in investments and decision-making and the psychology of money, I think getting involved on Twitter is a great idea. There's a community of people in so-called financial Twitter, or what we call, you know, shorthand, just FinTwit. And you could just go to hashtag FinTwit. There are 30, 40 plus people who are active in this FinTwit community on a daily basis, talking often in very non-technical, very understandable terms about better decision-making, better frameworks and mental models for understanding complex complex things. My handle on Twitter is just my name. It's at Brian Portnoy. So, you know, I think folks should follow me. And there's also on my feed under the lists, there's a tab of lists. I have a list on there called FinTwit. And I think it's sort of the top 30 people that I think you should follow. I think for people who like this stuff, being on Twitter, if you can ignore all of the toxic politics, it's a great place to be.
Well, I tell you, I hated Twitter for many years, mostly because I didn't understand it. And the only thing I could see were marketers and trolls. And I just couldn't weed myself out of that vortex. And now that I know how to ignore them or block them and just focus on the people that I consider to be interesting, then I'm finding the value of following people in Twitter. So that's great. Okay. And my last question is, how can people follow your work, your website? You told us your Twitter handle, your book, where, I mean, I know it's for sale in Amazon, but just give us the pitch for the book.
Oh, yeah. So, the book, there's, you know, sort of only one bookstore left in the world, and that's at Amazon.com. So the book is available there. You know, the nice thing about this experience since the book came out this in summer of 2018 is that I've gotten a lot of feedback, not just from sort of professional people in the world of money, but just from regular folks about, you know, how it was, you know, it's been meaningful to them to help them, you know, shape some of their ideas about how money fits into a meaningful life. It's really a book that's written for just the regular Joe. It's a book that's written for my family, for neighbors. So yeah, the book's available at Amazon. I can be followed at Brian Portnoy on Twitter. And then I have, there's two websites to point people to, at Virtus Investment Partners or Virtus.com, V-I-R-T-U-S. We have a whole thought leadership section where I direct a lot of content on making better decisions and understanding money better. And then I have my own personal website called shapingwealth.com. And, you know, for folks who want a little bit more background on me or want to get in touch with me, that's the right place to do it.
Yes, I just want to add that this is not the book. If you want to see how you can structure your portfolio and what's your asset allocation, this is not the book. This is a book to see the big picture of how finance fit into your life and your overall happiness.
I agree.
Okay, well, Brian, thank you so much for spending this time with us.
It was really a great conversation. Thank you so much.
Brian, thank you so much for coming over to the show. The subject of happiness and money is relevant to all of us. Also, it is relevant to all of us, the four C's: connection, control, competence, and context. We spoke about the constant hunger for more versus having enough. To the listeners, where are you in that spectrum? I feel that our lives are run by outsiders, by all the noise created by advertisers, social media, and just the people and society in general. And we don't have that much time to reflect and to find out where we can find true happiness, what's the real source of happiness. And I believe that your book, Brian, help us or take us one step closer towards that happiness. So thank you one more time for sharing your ideas with us. Now, to my fellow listeners, last week I made a mistake. I said that last week was the last podcast of the year. And of course, I made a mistake looking at my calendar. Today is December 31st. So today is, in fact, the last day of the year. So I want to take this opportunity to wish you Happy New Year's. So I hope you spend that time with your family, with your friends, that you have an amazing time and that you are full of goals and objectives for next year. I will be here motivating you, sharing stories with you, trying to take you, help you get one step farther in your quest for a better life, for more money, for more happiness. So I want to thank you one more time for being with me all this time. This is my first year as a podcaster. I started January something, I guess January 19, and it's been a long journey. I am a shy person, especially because English is not my first language. So I have been intimidated to do this podcast. But hey, we all have to push ourselves a little bit farther, push our boundaries to see if we can connect with more people, to see if we can influence some other life, to see if we can help each other. So thank you so much for being there for me, for listening. I can see from the statistics that the amount of people listening to the show continue increasing. Not immensely, but every week there is a few extra listeners, so something must be going on right. Now, finally, please connect with me. Some of you are doing it. I have one or two or three persons every week saying, hey, Alain, I listen to the podcast. But yeah, I know that many of you are in silence. So just reach out, say something, connect with me via Facebook, via LinkedIn, via Twitter, Instagram, whatever social media you use, or send me an email. And my email address is in the website. So go ahead, reach out, and it will be my pleasure to connect with you. One more time, guys, Happy New Year's, and I wish you the best. Goodbye.